Hi, everyone, and welcome back to Spotlight with Scientists in School, an educational charity that gets kids excited about science, tech, engineering, and math. Today on Spotlight, I'm thrilled to be having a conversation with Vinita Marwaha Madill. She is a space operations engineer from the UK who is now living in Canada. She is a science communicator and founder of Rocket Women. This is a global platform that empowers young women to pursue a career in STEM. This is a conversation you don't want to miss. Let's head on over and meet Vinita. Hi, everyone, and welcome to Spotlight, and welcome to Vinita. Thanks so much for being here with us today.
Thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
This is so exciting. So I let everyone know ahead of time in my opening that you are a space operations engineer, a science communicator, founder of Rocket Women, and you were also named one of 12 genius young women shaping the future by Elle's magazine. You're named the top 100 most influential female leaders in engineering in UK. It's pretty impressive.
Thank you.
And you've also been nominated for Women of the Year awards. How do you fit it all in? That's like a lot of stuff on your resume.
It's a lot of balancing. Yeah, I have a two-year-old as well. So yeah, it's a lot of life juggling, but making it all happen.
That's true. So Vinita, what inspired you to become a space operations engineer?
Yeah, so I've always been interested in space. And as a child, I loved reading and I read every space book that I could find in the library. And when I was young, I remember really sitting in the library and with a pile of books next to me. And in the books, among the images of space shuttle missions and NASA astronauts, I saw a woman in a spacesuit with brown hair like me and with a British flag on the spacesuit. And the caption next to it said that this is Helen Sharman and she's the first British astronaut. And so Helen Sharman flew to the Mir space station maybe about 2 years before I read that book. And so here was a woman in front of me, because I'm from the UK, and she's from the UK. And she studied chemistry and replied to a radio advert, and she beat 13,000 applicants to go to space. And I think for me, even at that young age, I think I was like 5 or 6, pretty young, in the library with my mum, looking at the image of Helen Sharman in her cycle spacesuit, I realized that that woman could be me. I think maybe I could be an astronaut too. And I think that really changed something inside me. And she showed me that my dreams were possible. And even though I didn't know it yet, she became a role model to me and helped to get me to where I am now.
I think that's exactly why you love this quote by Sally Ride. Mm-hmm. The first American woman in space says, "You cannot be what you cannot see."
That's true. Yeah, I really love that quote. So during my career, I've met some amazing women and especially other positive female role models. And I think you really need those role models out there, tangible and visible, to inspire the next generation. I think that's something that scientists in the school really do and really passionate about as well, which is fantastic. And so I started Rocket Women to make sure that these women's voices were heard and it was a platform for them to spread their advice. So we're interviewing women around the world in STEM, particularly in space. And I'm posting the interviews in Rocket Women along with the advice to encourage girls to be involved in STEM. But also for me on a personal level, I think there are so many stereotypes and cultural barriers that we need to overcome as well. So my background is British Asian. So my parents are originally, my grandparents are from India. So although my parents were really supportive of my interest in space and science, there was some pressure to study a traditional subject for a girl. So become a dentist or a doctor or a pharmacist or a teacher. And those are all fantastic careers. But for them, for my parents, it was a safe choice and acceptable choice for a girl in South Asian culture. So I actually worked for the dental nurse on the weekends while studying in, I think, probably grade 12. So in the UK, and it really helped both my parents and I understand that although I enjoyed some aspects of the role on the medical side of things, especially I think being a dentist wasn't really for me. So it was a great role to learn about the being responsible for other people's care and medical tasks. And then when I went on to the European Space Agency as a contractor, I worked on some of the medical aspects of preparing a launch campaign where the team go to a launch site. So for that particular project, it was in Baikonur in Kazakhstan to prepare the European robotic arm for launch, is what we were doing as operations engineers for the mission that I worked on there. So I've also worked in the European Space Agency's space medicine office as well. So it's certainly interest that I have, and having some background in this has really helped. But I think ultimately we need those role models to really address the lack of minority ethnic women in STEM, especially, and really ensure that their stories are visible and able to inspire and support, I think, the future career decisions that young women make, mm-hmm. but also provide their parents as well, which is really important, and their peers with examples of successful careers. And so through Rocket Women, we're really helping and making sure that these stories of diverse women in STEM globally are visible to the next generation, but also to the parents, peers, and teachers and carers that are helping to make those decisions.
I'm glad you mentioned scientists in school as well, because we believe exactly the same thing. So when we have our presenters, we try to make sure that we have a diverse background, because every child sitting on that carpet looking up has to be able to see themselves as a person in STEM. I was really surprised, Vinita, to read that only 12% of engineers in the UK are female. And that's the lowest in Europe. Why do you think that is?
Yeah, that is very low. So I think I'm based in Canada now as well.
Yes.
So if you look at Canada, I think it's around 23%. So it's a bit higher.
A little bit higher.
Yeah, a little bit higher. Still not 50%, but
no.
A little bit higher. and I think in Canada, in engineering specifically, it's just under 20% of all students are female. Mm-hmm. And as you mentioned, in the UK, it's quite low. It's at 12% of the engineering workforce being female. And actually only under 8% of that are from minority ethnic backgrounds as well, compared to around 12% of the UK population. So it's certainly something that we need to work on to improve. And I think more importantly, looking at the reasons why, but also why it's important to change this, is that the gender and racial diversity in STEM is not just, including the space sector, it's not just an issue of inequality, but it also affects the engineering that we do and the systems that we create as well. So I think the creators and developers of the systems and technologies, so from you look at technology today, from AI algorithms to facial recognition, so these really important mm-hmm. technologies are going to be so integral in the future as well. We really need to, those creators of these technologies really need to represent diverse backgrounds, cultures, and experiences to make sure that these technologies are to prevent unconscious biases and the design of the technologies, and also make sure they work for society as a whole. So I think that's really important as well, just to look at the why and look mm-hmm. at the future to see why it's something that we need to work on. But also I think we really need diversity in the sector to really reflect more of society, and to make sure right now more than ever we need 100% of the talent available to solve the really hard problems that we have, I think especially in the world today. So that's something that at Rocket Women we're really passionate about to improve, and that's really a core goal of ours as well.
Well, I find interesting is even if the percentage is, say, like you said, 24% mm-hmm. that go into the program, it doesn't necessarily translate to 24% of women are in the engineering jobs. Somehow, you know, they get the degree, but it doesn't necessarily translate to a job in engineering.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's also something called the leaky pipeline syndrome as well. So I think as you go through, something that I saw as well, it's one of the reasons why I started Rocket Women, is that as I went through my career, less and less women came along that journey with me from mm-hmm. graduating as an engineer to eventually working in the space sector and having the opportunity to enter the space sector as well. And I think one of the big points in that was the fact that the stereotype of an engineer when you're growing up, but also when you're in the sector and when you're studying science and engineering, that really needs to change. So you can really see yourself in that role. So I'm also really excited to be involved in some work with the Royal Academy of Engineering in the UK. So they have a really great campaign called This is Engineering, and that really celebrates the engineers that are shaping the world around us. So then that's really at the heart of everything you do, from sort of satellite technology, to the special effects in your favorite science fiction show, to clean water and your mobile phone. So engineering is really in everything that you do. You use it every day in your life. And there's a really narrow and outdated stereotype of engineers and what they do and the role they play in society. So that can actually prevent some students and also graduates from considering these rewarding and varied careers in their future.
Right. And with Rocket Women, you also have a scholarship as well?
Yes. So we have a scholarship program that I'm really passionate about. So that was one of my goals when I started. I really wanted to make a difference, a difference that was tangible as well. And so from talking to parents and carers of students, I think one of the things that came up is that to study engineering, but also especially in the space sector, it's really a cause of having the opportunities and equal access to those opportunities in education as well. So we started a scholarship that really wants to make a change, and it was really born from a desire to make a difference as well. And so proceeds from Rocket Women clothing and our apparel range goes towards a scholarship for young women in STEM that choose to study science and engineering. And I think, like I mentioned before, representation really matters. And I think
yes.
through this scholarship, we want to encourage diverse and talented individuals to pursue opportunities in STEM that may not have had that chance otherwise. And I think even for myself, from a personal level, without the fortuity of scholarships myself, I wouldn't have able to,
right.
been able to complete my studies internationally.
Right.
And also to reach my goals in the space yes. industry. So in space specifically, there's if you for graduate studies, then there's a few places in the world that you can study. And one of those places is the International Space University that I was fortunate to study at. And so for me, that was a really, that was an inflection point in my career and for so many other people as well. Mm. And so for right now, the scholarship goes towards helping a woman to study at the International Space University Space Studies program that can really
yeah.
Kind of support them and get them into the industry as well. So we want to empower women with our clothing range, but also build opportunities for young people to through the proceeds and supporting the scholarship as well to make a difference in the world.
We have the same goal at Scientists in School as well, because we have funding partners, of course, that help us make sure that these workshops and all the STEM enrichment are for every child across Canada. And we also have a crowdfunding page as well, because COVID-19 really impacted charities. And it's the same thing. We want to make sure that, you know, this is accessible to everybody, just like you're saying. Exactly.
Yeah.
You've been involved in a lot of space projects. Tell me your the one that you're most excited about to share with people.
I think one of the first projects that I was involved is, and it's something that is still dear to my heart. So I was working at the skin suit project at the European Space Agency as a trainee. So I knew I wanted to work in space suit design, but I'm from the UK and there aren't many space suits being developed in the UK. And I couldn't really find one in the US that I could work on due to nationality issues. And so I hunted for a space suit project and I found one, and it was called the Skin Suit Project. And it was based at the European Space Agency's European Astronaut Center in Cologne in Germany. And so the International Space University actually started there as an intern. So I was a trainee and then went on to consult on the project and work on the suit itself. And so I found the group there and I persuaded them to let me work on the suit as an intern. And I started there in around 2010. So what it does is in space, astronauts lose around 2 to 3% of their bone mass on the space station during a 6-month mission. And also they grow 4 to 6 centimeters taller. And that can be quite painful for them. And it also impacts their spinal health as well. An example is astronaut Anne McLean, and she grew about 5 centimeters during
that's incredible.
Yeah.
That's absolutely. Incredible. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and we have to actually adjust the spacesuits to take that into account as well. And so through the skin suit, it's something that we can use, we're using on the space station now, but also future missions to the moon and to Mars. It helps to improve the spinal health, and it provides loading onto an astronaut's body from the shoulders down to their feet, essentially recreates the effect of gravity on their skeleton to try and prevent that. And it's been amazing to see the suit being developed as a prototype so many years ago, and then eventually being used on the space station in the last few years. So initially it was used by the European Space Agency's Danish astronaut Andreas Mogensen, and also after that by the French European Space Agency astronaut Thomas Pesquet during his 6-month mission to the International Space Station as well. So it's really exciting to see, hopefully making a difference, but also especially for the future of exploration as well, something that we can use to improve astronauts' health in space.
You're now living in Canada. Mm-hmm. How has the switch been from the UK to Canada?
It's been good. So I being in the space industry, I've been very fortunate to have been able to work internationally. And so I worked in the Netherlands for the last few years at the European Space Agency's Technology Centre. And then I was based in the UK for a bit and then moved to Ottawa in early this year. It's been good. I came in the winter, so I got to experience Canadian winter for the first time properly in Ottawa. So that was
went from skin suit to snow suit.
I did. Lots of snow suits. I got a proper winter coat. But no, it's been a good transition as well. So my family's pretty happy here. But
that's fantastic. That's great.
There's lots of really exciting activities right now in the space industry as well in Canada. So it's really great to be involved as well. So currently I work at a company called Mission Control Space Services in Ottawa as a project manager, and also work on the operations as well there. So we initially started out developing technology for planetary rovers, and then we also, now we develop valuable tools to solve software challenges as well, broadly looking at software for robotics and spaceflight as well. And we also, I think the really exciting thing is I have a Mission Control Academy as well. So that's an education outreach program that I'm involved in as well. So it's a, and we've actually carried out the students on four continents right now. And the great thing is that it's remote. So it lets any classroom with an internet connection learn about planetary science and engineering, and also operate a real rover prototype deployed in a Mars analog location or a moon analog location as well. So that's really exciting. That's something that we'd love to kind of take further. So we've done it in, especially in Canada recently as well. So the students learn about planetary science and rover design, and actually plan and execute an exploration mission. And I think that's a really unique opportunity for students to actually get such a hands-on opportunity to actually work with professionals in the space industry to learn about these things firsthand. And we've also now creating our own lunar test bed as well, like an analog terrain in Ottawa as well for that, and also for testing as well. But I think if you're a student wanting to get into the space industry in Canada, it's a really exciting time to do that right now.
That's really great to know. Yes.
Yeah.
That's exciting. So what advice would you give your 10-year-old self?
It's a really good question.
Yeah.
I think I would tell my 10-year-old self that it's really possible to achieve your goal, whether it's to work in the space industry or otherwise. I think that's a really important point to remember. And I think it really takes hard work and dedication, but it's absolutely worth it as well. So just to keep your focus and really believe in yourself as well. And I think for me, I think one of the major points in my career was going to the International Space University. And I studied physics and engineering, but I didn't know how to get into the space university. So I knew I wanted to become an astronaut when I was younger, but I didn't know how to do that. So what I did is I printed out the NASA astronaut guidelines from the NASA website, and I stuck these to the inside cover of my secondary school folder, so my high school folder. And they really gave me a point to look at every single day. Yes. And I think the first guideline was that you needed a master's degree in science, engineering, biology, or physics. So that really led me on the path to study science and engineering, and then go to International Space University as well. And I think almost everyone that I know working in the space industry and otherwise has felt like their future career was unknown at times. So I think really pursuing your passion and persevering is important, whether you're able to do that in your main job or even as a side hustle or as a volunteering job as well. So I think it's really important to pay attention to what subjects you really enjoy and the work that you're doing. So I think, yeah, really pay attention to what your passion is and then persevere in that.
Yeah. Now you've traveled the world. What's one of your favorite places you've been to?
So I would say my favorite place is, I think, with my family. So I have a little 2-year-old now, so I love spending time with him. I think one of the benefits of actually having all this time at home is actually been able to spend more time with family. So that's been really great. And I think my happy place is at space conferences as well. So you're surrounded by so many amazing, inspirational people. Yeah. And I love learning about the new technologies that we're working on. So I think really being at space conferences and learning about that. And so we're working on really exciting things in the future. So there's a gateway project as well that's being designed by the European Space Agency in conjunction with international partners, so the Japanese Space Agency and the Canadian Space Agency as well, that we're building on the cooperation from the International Space Station as well. So it's going to be humanity's next step beyond low Earth orbit and out into the solar system. So it's like 1,000 times further out into the solar system than the International Space Station. So it's really exciting projects that I love learning about at space conferences, but also reconnecting with individuals there as well and friends.
So would you go to space then if you were asked?
I would love to, yeah. I think there's so many opportunities to do that now. I think coming up, it's a really exciting time for space tourism. And yeah, there's lots of ways, hopefully, that everybody can go to space in the future. So I'd love to.
Yeah. Vinita, thank you so much. This has been so inspirational. I'm sure there are lots of young girls and boys watching this thinking, yes, I would love to grow up and be a space engineer. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It was great to be here. Thanks for
Thank time. You. Thanks so much for watching Spotlight with Scientists in School. To find out more information, check out our website, scientistsinschool.ca. We have Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and we are new to Instagram, @sci_in_school. And finally, in response to COVID-19, we have launched an emergency crowdfunding campaign. Make a donation or share the link using the hashtag #StandUpForFutureScientists. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you next time on Spotlight.